to the Super Nerd Factory podcast. I'm here with my host, as always, Josh.
Hey.
And our special guest, Tim.
Hello.
So, Tim, you are the front runner for your website. Sorry, man, I farted. And we're here to interview you.
All right. Yeah. Sorry, man, I farted. Board gaming podcast and review website. We're just starting to do video, and I have no clue what I'm doing.
Fantastic.
You'll fit right in.
All right.
Because we have no idea what we're doing either.
Did you notice how John uses his rap hands when doing the intro?
I do.
I almost wanted a ghetto horn to go off. Just burr, burr, burr.
We can make that happen.
I have the ham horn app.
He does too. Don't make him bring it out because I don't want to hear it.
What did you record as your ham horn?
I have an app that has it on it.
No. I mean, but you can do your own recording. Do you have the ham horn?
No, I do not have the ham horn.
All right, after this, I got to show you what ham horn is, because you can do your own recording, and okay. Then you can press the button and make it do that instead.
Oh, you can just make it go brr, 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 brr.
Like, so it can go brr, 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 or it can go ham, 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 or you can set your own recording of you saying whatever you want. So if you just want Josh's laugh over and over again, it can be like,
No,
yeah.
We don't, nobody wants that.
I kind of want that.
I'll make one special for you.
Thanks.
No, we just edit Josh's laugh out of the entire podcast.
Right. Yep. Josh has no sense of humor. We know this.
Our podcast is actually like 6 hours long, and we edit it down to an hour. It's just me laughing for 5 hours.
That sounds like our podcast. We will record for 3 to 4 hours at a time, and I release 20 minutes of content.
Well, getting into that, so why don't you tell us about how you had the idea for Sorry Man, I Farted, and how you got started.
So I started playing board games with a friend, Matt B, that the three of us know, and nobody watching this knows. Or listening to this, and he took me to PAX East, and at that point I had started collecting a bunch of board games, and at PAX East I realized we could go to PAX for free if I had a review site.
Mm-hmm.
And so I started looking into what it would take and listening to other shows, and then in July I had a really big yard sale and made a shit ton of money. Oh, is cursing allowed?
Yes. We
hell no.
We don't give a fuck.
Sweet. I figured I should have asked that way beforehand, but whatever.
No, but it's better just do it live.
Just say fuck it.
Yeah, this is the internet.
I know, right? We're allowed to say whatever we want.
We talked about ass to mouth last week.
Hitler did nothing wrong. So,
God, we're getting pulled off the internet already, Josh.
Sorry, guys. First interview, right down the drain. So I sold a bunch of stuff at this yard sale and made a bunch of money and bought a USB microphone and said, hey, we're going to start a podcast. And that night recorded episode 0, which was Katie and I trying to figure out what the hell to call the thing. And we are now 100 episodes in and well into our way into season 2.
Actually, you know what? I listened to that episode because weren't you calling people trying to figure out?
Yeah, I was cold calling people. I called my brother. I called a friend of ours, Mary Beth. And I tried calling Matt B and he didn't answer. And my mom didn't answer either. So Mary Beth and my brother were the only ones to actually answer. My brother said, why are you doing any of this?
That was the best part of that podcast. He's like, why are you even doing this?
Yeah, he was like, why are you?
He's like so uninterested in what was happening.
He cared not for, and he still doesn't.
He doesn't play games at all?
No. Well, he plays your typical party games. So like Apples to Apples or Quelf or he's a big fan of Outburst.
Okay, like yeah, the generic go-to party games.
The really shitty party games.
Yeah.
So we did have a bunch of, it was a call-in special, and we're doing the same thing for episode 100. Episode 100 is us playing a game, and then there's going to be a supplementary episode after it that is another call-in special, and it's all the guests that we had on the show, including Mary Beth from episode 0, and none of the other hosts of the show know it's happening. I've been doing it in secret, and I'm going to surprise them with it, I think, this week or next week, and we're going to record their reactions to it.
Nice. So
how many episodes have you done total as of now?
Released or actually recorded?
Both.
Released, we have, it's 145 because we do live episodes that aren't a part of our canon, quote unquote.
Yeah.
We do the story time with Smith, which is every last Wednesday of every month. That wasn't even English. And I host a show. Oh, I'm the worst. The last Wednesday of every month, we play a storytelling game where we create...
Yeah, I played that.
Yeah, you played an episode of it. We have a universe that all of this stuff takes place in, and we just continue the story using medieval-themed playing cards in a current-day setting. Our heroes of the story are Ice-T, Arnold Palmer, and Ice Cube.
Fantastic.
And they are the best cop duo of Wilkes-Barre, Pennsylvania.
Great.
So it's been really fun. And total recorded, we are over 200. I'd say we're probably close to 230.
Wow.
So a lot of that is live store episodes and a couple more of the story time episodes, including one with Mad Libs, which was hysterical. And then we're working on season two as we speak.
Yeah, that's cool. The so do you have a favorite game?
Yes. Currently, for the longest time, it was a game called Alhambra, which is a really, it seems boring on paper. You collect money to buy tiles to build a city, or depending on which version you're playing, you're building a palace. But that's rapidly getting shifted to a game called Zoneplex, which involves you being a monk in the nth dimension. A pyramid has come through a black hole, and you are exploring it, and at the very top of it is a device that controls the universe.
That sounds amazing.
Yeah, it's...
I'd watch that movie.
It's 2112, the board game. So,
okay.
So when we were playing it, we were drinking Mountain Dew Code Red, and I jokingly put on Rush's 2112, like, oh, well, this is going to be this. And we finished and was like, that was the most perfect gaming experience we have ever had.
Yeah.
But you're just hopped up on caffeine.
Not really. I mean, I drank like 7 Code Reds, but you're talking to a guy that drinks 3 Monsters a day to go to sleep.
Yeah, generally, it's very rare I see you without a Monster.
It's true. I have cut back lightly, mostly because I've been impoverished.
Yeah.
And Monsters are expensive.
Yes, they are.
But also, every so often I go through this weird shift where I start to cut caffeine out of my life just so I can drink a Mountain Dew for science.
Okay.
The longest stretch I've ever gone without caffeine was 1.5 years. And that's zero caffeine. So no tea, no chocolate, nothing that contains caffeine or any kind of energy supplement.
What about cheese? Cheese contains caffeine.
Okay, I ate a little bit of cheese. So it's not a fully... Yeah, damn it. Now you're upping the stakes.
I'm just... I used to have a stomach ulcer problem. They told me to cut out caffeine and nicotine, and they said don't eat cheese.
That's really weird. So now I'm going to go on a diet of potatoes for the next 1.5 years.
Potatoes or away from potatoes?
Just potatoes.
Okay, I can do that.
Yeah, I could totally do that.
In fact, I'm pretty much there.
I'm pretty close. Potatoes and pasta.
Potatoes and rice for me. I eat a lot of rice.
I'm against rice.
Why don't you want rice?
There's potatoes and pasta out there.
But rice is so easy to make.
I hate
minute rice.
Nope.
So when my divorce was going on and I was living by myself and didn't have a girlfriend and was just in a trailer in the middle of nowhere, all I ate was Zatarain's rice mix every night for about 6 months straight. So I totally love rice, but I'm giving it a break. We're taking a break from each other at the moment.
Man, I don't blame
you. That's a complete bullshit. I had rice for dinner tonight.
Nice.
So everything you said,
I had rice tonight too.
I had rice and potatoes.
Okay.
Yeah.
I could do that.
So how do you have rice and potatoes?
It was
normally those are like two separate starches that you keep separate.
I could go full dinner starches.
I'm going to blow your guys' minds. It was rice, mashed potatoes, peas, carrots, corn, and ground beef. It was a shepherd's pie.
Okay. All right. I could do that.
Shepherd's pie is a little different. That's not like you just have like a spoonful of rice and like a spoonful of mashed potatoes. Everything's just kind of mixed all together in a shepherd's pie.
Well, yeah, but it was delicious.
I'm not denying that.
Right. So anyway, the longest stretch I went without caffeine other than cheese was 1.5 years, and I drank a Mountain Dew and could have sworn I saw Jesus. Like, it was the most hyper I've ever been in my entire life. So yeah, that's what that is. I don't even remember how we got to that point.
We never do.
Okay, cool.
Now, so big part, at least from looking at your site, the big part of what you guys do is a lot of Kickstarter coverage.
We do a weekly Kickstarter episode every Saturday where we pick a game usually provided to us or one that we have backed. So it's not always something that you can actively get on Kickstarter, but it was fully funded on Kickstarter. We do believe in that mentality of crowdsourcing and looking to your peers to develop something that you appreciate and that you think they would. That being said, there's a lot of crap on Kickstarter. But there's a lot of dreams, like people's dreams that they've worked very, very hard to get to and simply can't afford to do it. It's such a great medium to get out there and get people's attention.
Yeah.
And so every Saturday we review a game from Kickstarter, whether it's active or just finished or just about to release or has already been released. We've done Cards Against Humanity. one of the most recent ones we did was a game called Rar, where you're a kaiju in a city trying to destroy it. It was really bad.
I think I did hear about that one.
Yeah, it was disappointing because everything about the game looked great, even the Kickstarter page and the box it comes in, all the cards and stuff. But playing the game, it was just boring.
Yeah.
It was one of those where if you don't know what your strategy is at the beginning, you're going to lose mid-game.
So you could tell it was like a graphic designer made a game.
Oh, it's
didn't play games.
It's a graphic designer's wet dream for sure.
Okay.
It's what I'm afraid Exploding Kittens is going to be.
When does that come out?
July is, according to the last update, it should be July or middle of August.
So that's a big thing. Like when I look at Kickstarter stuff is, especially with some of these bigger games, it's like you look at the release time, some can be like a year or so away.
The best games that you can get on Kickstarter take a year to arrive.
They put work into it.
Yeah, if it says that it's coming, unless they say that they've done all of the playtesting, the game is pure, and they show you rules, because that is the most important part of a game. The components and everything else doesn't matter. The rules are what matter. And unless they have those to show, then you want a decent amount of lead time before you get the game in hand so they can play test it and make sure that everything works the way that they think it will. Another thing you should watch out for is stretch goals that add cards with bonus effects on them. A lot of more Kickstarters are getting smarter with it, where they actually have them pre-made and ready to go before the Kickstarter launches. But a lot of them are adding them as stretch goals on the fly because the game is doing way better than they expected. And those aren't play tested.
Oh, I see what you mean. So it like ruins the balance of the game.
Completely ruins it.
Okay.
And the only reason that you back a Kickstarter, sadly to say, that most people back a Kickstarter is to get those exclusive cards.
Yeah.
And when you get one that completely ruins the game, it ruins the game.
And it's kind of the same thing. Like video games have that issue with pre-order stuff. Like, getting God mode because you pre-order a game and it ruins the whole thing.
You have to pre-order it from 7 different places and you can completely break the game.
Yeah. Well, that's like Mortal Kombat. They have, you can buy easy fatalities because people can't do fatalities. Even though there's 6 button presses, they have a thing in Mortal Kombat X where you can actually pay for easy fatalities. You push a button and it goes off.
That's really dumb.
Yeah, yeah. It's stupid.
And it's like $10.
That's another big reason why we started the podcast and I started board gaming. I had been playing video games for a very long time, and I just kept getting, salty is not even the word. I was getting bored with them. I realized that they're telling the same stories over and over again, and when Bioshock, Bioshock 2, and Bioshock Infinite are my favorite games, simply because of the story they tell, it tells me that there's something wrong with gaming.
Uh-huh.
Like, I've reached a critical mass where I can't be impressed by a video game anymore.
Yeah. And well, I guess on the same aspect, though, like looking through like Kickstarter, once again, for video games, a lot of crap on there, but you also have the weird standout.
Well, so a lot of the weird standouts in Kickstarter video games are platformers, and I still religiously play platformers.
Okay.
I absolutely love them, and I think that Fez being a great example of it, rest in peace, Phil Fish, or at least your brain, he created one of the greatest platformers that did something that you didn't see in a video game. And
yeah, like the way that he designed that game was ridiculous.
And the story that it tells is brilliant. Like, it's a beautiful game all around. Every aspect of that game is beautiful. Super Meat Boy being another great example of it. And I know I'm just rattling off indie game, the movie, but Super Meat Boy impressed the hell out of me. My all-time favorite video game of the moment, at least in the last 3 years that I've played, was Hotline Miami.
Yeah.
And uh-huh. I just got Hotline Miami 2. The thing that blew my mind about that game is there's so many top-down shooters, Grand Theft Auto, that style game, where the enemies don't blitz you, and you're basically playing Splinter Cell in a Grand Theft Auto game. And I love Hotline Miami because every enemy, as soon as they see you, they blitz you and they kill you. Mm-hmm. And that's not something you would ever see in a game ever.
Yeah, because people want easy satisfaction.
No, I love a game that actually challenges your brain and you have to think about what you're going to do. Like, there's a point in Hotline Miami where you realize you can walk around the building before you go into it. And when you start doing that and planning your attack, you realize, oh my God, this is a war game. Like, it's not a shoot 'em up video game. You are planning your assault on this Death Star.
Oh, yeah. Happy Star Wars Day.
We're dating it. We said we weren't going
to
do that.
It doesn't matter. It's Star Wars Day. Yeah. We have ruined. To date Star Wars.
Do it over again.
Nope.
Fuck it. We're doing it live.
I only ever do it in one take, so you guys deal with it.
Actually, that's a good question. Have you ever had to redo one of your podcasts?
So the very first, the the first three podcasts we did were recorded through the microphone on my laptop, and I learned a very valuable lesson. Dell makes really shitty microphones.
Yes, oh, like you were actually doing off the laptop mic.
I pressed record on the laptop, and then we were talking to the laptop.
Oh, okay.
And no, I got them cleaned up enough that I was like, I could release these. And then I was like, no, let's just replay it. We recorded an episode. So the going joke on our show is that we will never review Love Letter. We've played it in a bunch of live store episodes, and we've done three episodes for it. We've recorded three review episodes for it. None of them got released because of bad audio issues.
So it's like the curse?
Yeah, so we're never going to do a review of Love Letter, which is one of the greatest gateway games made. It's a game that I could play with John right now and get him into board gaming easily. Uh-huh.
Yeah, I have. It's
you've
good
played
game.
It, yeah. And so, yeah, we will never... We've recorded three full episodes of that that all got scrapped. The first three were Love Letter, Coup, and Forbidden Island, and those were all awful. So we wound up re-recording the Coup and Forbidden Island. We actually got Katie drunk for Forbidden Island. That was pretty fun. And then there was a point where I was recording through Gold Wave, and I realized that Gold Wave is really shitty for recording through a USB mic. Using a mixing board, you can control a lot of it, and I just said, fuck it, and tried recording through Audacity, and it sounded perfect.
Okay, so pretty much it was like the natural growing pains of just starting.
Yep. The only other show that we've scrapped in the last... since we started that was legit for poor recording was Star Wars Imperial Assault. The gaming store Cloud City in Allentown was doing a demo of it, and I sent our one host, Jeff, to record it with our little handy mic. Gave him the tripod and everything, showed him how to set it up, said, this is how you're going to mic the room because it's really easy. I don't need to hear everything that's going on. I just want your reactions. And about halfway through it, the battery died, and he never replaced it, and the audio that he got was so bad, because it's just somebody was banging on the table over and over again.
Yeah.
So that's the only other show that got scrapped. Everything else is getting released.
Okay.
Yeah, technically, we've released everything, but...
We have one that never released.
Oh, the Super Secret Show.
Yeah.
That one was just horrible.
We don't talk about that show.
So, Katie...
But that was out of our hands.
So what actually happened was... Yeah, recording was cutting out, like, every other word.
Yeah, it looked like it was recording. It looked like it was recording fine for us, but when we went to go to, like, re-listen to it and edit it, it was, like, every middle word was just cut out, but it smashed everything together.
To where it looked like it was there.
So it was like...
Did we freeze?
We didn't freeze.
Huh. I don't see it moving.
He has it zoomed way out.
Oh, okay. Don't touch it.
I'm going to touch it.
Don't touch it. I don't want to see it.
Touch it. It's moving. You're good.
All right. I get scared because of that moment.
Yeah, see, we talk about it, and then my computer decides to eat it.
I don't zoom out. I just keep it right in there.
One of the things...
We actually did research online.
Yeah, with a lot of research was with having... It has to buffer that next part of the screen, so depending on your computer, it can eat it.
Yeah. So okay. It takes a very minor percentage of CPU. We're just cutting that out.
Gotcha.
So we can put more CPU during for our other stuff. So I know you guys, you have a crew that you generally play with.
Yeah, it's me, our graphic designer and game designer, Jeff. He's a buddy of mine that I met playing a game called Netrunner. And he has his own game called Swarm, if you want to go to the Game Crafter and check it out. Or he's launching a Kickstarter May 15th.
Is that how you met him, through Swarm?
No, I met him through playing Netrunner at Cloud City.
Oh, yeah, you just said that.
Yeah, I did.
I'm paying attention. It's
no, you're
cool.
Not. So I met him through that and then said, hey, we're doing this podcast and I really want to interview game designers. Would you want to come over and bring your game? He brought it over and then just continued to show up every Tuesday.
You just never could get rid of him again.
Right, and then it's like a high fidelity. You know, I brought him in for extra work one day. That was 4 years ago. They've come every day ever since. And that's kind of how it happened. He started showing up every Tuesday. We had him on as a special guest. Like, I was doing the whole faking, like, oh, we got Jeff back, and it's the same night, third recording. And then finally, I was just like, Jeff, do you want to be a co-host? And he goes, I thought I already was. And I was like, uh-huh. We'll make it official. And then we recorded an episode saying that he was the co-host, and I waited 6 months to release it just to fuck with him.
Nice.
And then we have Katie, my girlfriend. So the idea behind the show was we were going to have four people on it that represent four different types of gamers.
Okay.
So it's me, Jeff, Katie, and then Matt B. I represent the chaotic gamer. I'm not out to win. I'm out to have a really good time and make you confused as to why you even play. Jeff is hardcore competitive. Actually, he's more hardcore chaotic.
He's into, like, he plays Dungeons and Dragons and stuff, right?
No. He plays a lot of card games. So Netrunner, Magic, The Gathering.
Okay, that's his main go-to.
Yeah, he likes a war-based miniature game called Monsterpocalypse, which is a bunch of kaiju fighting each other. Think Warhammer, but with Godzilla.
Okay.
So he's more hardcore chaotic. He will play to win, but he's going to do it in a very strange fashion.
Okay, and I guess that makes sense because all those games are very much versus games.
Right. Well, you got to outthink your opponent, and the best way to outthink them is to not think at all.
Yeah.
And then we have Matt, who is hardcore competitive. He is always out to win. He is out for blood any which way he can get it. And then we have Katie, who doesn't want to play the game at all.
Yep.
So those are the four different examples of gamers. The idea behind the show is to represent those four different versions of gamers and then also introduce a game. So one person at the table hasn't played the game, at least one. Usually it's all four of us and we're learning it as we play it.
Yeah.
It's to show that the greatest thing about a board game is that first initial reaction. So a lot of our stuff is generally positive, but that shows that the game is worth playing once. So if you go to a gaming night or if somebody says, hey, do you want to try this? You can say, yeah, I definitely want to try that. We're not out there for the hardcore, should you purchase this game type of review. We are there for,
is it worth playing with some friends?
Right. Is the game even worth playing? Because there are a lot of games where we will play them. It'll be somebody's first time and they'll be like, this is really bad. And then that gives you your out, you know?
Yeah, I guess that makes sense. Mm-hmm. Always have that person that has no idea what's going on.
Katie's perfect for it too, because there's games where she will look at it like Roar. She was all about it. She's like, this looks awesome. Look at the little butterfly. Like, this is like shiny objects. And then we played it and she was like, this is really bad. And then, but we all came to that same agreement.
Yeah. Now, I know a lot of times, I guess from the Facebook picture you have is like the background of your game collection. So I bring up your site, that's like, is that the guy that has all those games?
So that was my game collection in August of last year. It has tripled in size.
Do you know how many games you have?
The last count was over 400.
Wow.
Yeah.
But don't you have multiples of stuff?
No. I have a couple expansions that we do count into it, but different games, there's over 300.
That's ridiculous.
I know.
That's crazy.
I think I have like 6 board games.
Total?
Because I don't play board games.
So you're like Charlie Bucket? Like,
yes.
How many did you have? I had 6. All right, 6 cases of games. No, just 6.
I don't have all that many. I have a handful.
Well, to be fair, the podcast launched my collection into the stratosphere. I had purchased about 60 games between February of last year and July when we started the show. And then from July on, it was anytime I could find a game for cheap, or like I would start going to thrift stores and picking up everything that I could.
Okay.
And then if eBay was having a sale, or like if I could find it really cheap on eBay or Amazon, or just when my local game store does a special event, I'll go just so I can get 20% off of the game.
Yeah, but I mean, in a relatively short amount of time, that's a lot of games.
It's a ton of games. Katie's not happy.
I bet not.
No. We have gotten rid of a couple games, stuff that we know we won't ever play again. We tend to put them in our prize bin, so if you come to one of our live events, you can win a game that we played on the show.
Yeah.
So, and it's not all bad stuff. Some of it is stuff we genuinely hated and we just don't ever want to see on our shelf again.
Yeah.
Other stuff is stuff that we enjoyed, but I have a game that's similar to it, so I don't need this one.
Yeah. Well, speaking of live stuff, you've done multiple live events, right?
Yeah. We've done the Love Letter demo event at the Portal, Love Letter demo event at Cloud City, a couple random live events at each store that we just kind of announced. We did International Tabletop Day at the Portal this year. And PAX East, we hosted a panel there.
So everything looped back around. Is that the moment we're like, we did it?
So yeah, it was funny. When I submitted for the panel at PAX, I was like, there's no way they're going to go for this. And then they sent back the reply saying, yeah, we would love to have you. And I was like, oh shit.
What do we do?
I got to think of something to talk about for an hour. Like, they're giving me an hour of time on a stage. And yeah. I was like, all right, well, I said we were going to do gaming with grandma, how to introduce your family to board games. It's kind of like...
That's how
I pitched it.
Okay.
Yeah. Right. And what I had in my head was I was going to write an idea that was so obscure that I could easily come up with something to fill an hour.
Okay.
And then as I started working out the details of what we were going to talk about for an hour, I realized it's the equivalent of coming out to your parents. So like you're saying like, oh, I'm a board gamer. This is what I do. And it's like the same as I like to blow dudes. I don't know what. And the true litmus test for that was trying to get my dad to play a board game. I still haven't. He and I played Risk when I was younger constantly. And I've tried to show him a bunch of games that are like Risk that are newer and much more fresh and have cool rule sets. And he has no interest whatsoever in it.
Yeah, I guess some people just aren't into things.
No. He likes sitting in front of his computer and watching old boxing matches.
Nice.
Yeah. My dad is like the quintessential dad. when you watch an old sitcom and the dad's sitting on a couch with a hand in his pants, no shirt on, that's my dad.
Nice. And so he's like Homer Simpson kind of dude?
Kind of, yeah. He eats a ton of meat too. He lives a mile away from a butcher. So every day he's got some fresh cut in his fridge that he's just ready to cook up. So I do enjoy going to visit him because I get steak.
Very nice.
So when you finally did this PAX panel, did it work all right? How do you do?
We were terrified. I didn't show it because Katie was shitting a brick. But we all went up and I told everybody bring a game idea that you would introduce people to, and all four of us gave our idea. I was kind of the moderator of the panel, so I would bounce back between Jeff, Katie, and Matt. And then we opened up for questions at the end, and it was brilliant. It actually was one of the best things I've ever done. We talked to 186 people, and we had a bunch of people come up to us after the fact and say they really enjoyed the panel and appreciated what we were saying and liked what we did. We then walked around the panel floor the exhibition floor and wound up getting a ton of demo copies of games. I think I walked out of there with like 7 or 8 different board games, each costing about $50 a piece.
Wow. Now, was this just kind of just because you did the panel, like people were like, hey, I saw you did this?
We were legitimized by having the badges that said special guest.
Okay.
So when we would go up to a booth, they would say, why are you a special guest? And we would say, oh, we hosted this panel on tabletop. And they would go, oh, why? And I'd show them the card and explain to them what we do. And they'd be like, well, would you want to review our game? And I'd go, sure,
I guess.
I always tried to make it seem like I was pained to do it, even though yes, I was screaming on the inside.
Like yeah.
This little 5-year-old in my head is just bouncing around on like high on caffeine.
Yeah, it's like okay, play it cool.
Yeah. You gotta pretend like you don't want to do this, but you really want to do this.
You know, like Van Damme. Before you went out to someone, you'd be like, Van Damme. All right.
It honestly felt like the third date when she's like, hey, do you want to come back to my place? And you don't want to go, yes! Like, you
just want, I guess I don't have anything going on.
Yeah, let me check my schedule. You know, a TV show is on tonight that I really want to watch. But I guess I can, whatever. So, yeah, same kind of idea was like, they were like, do you want to review our game? And I'm looking at it like, I have wanted to play that game for so long.
Yeah.
And I'm like, sure? And then they go back to, like, because they have a whole table full of everything they produce, and I'm just looking at the game that I want, and they put their hand on it, and then they reach behind it for something, and I'm like, oh damn it, and they pull out another copy of that game, and I'm like, yes.
Now are you guys planning on doing it again, going to PAX?
Absolutely. So next year we want to go to PAX, and next year we would also like to go to Gen Con, which is all board gaming. It's the biggest board gaming convention in America.
Where is that?
That is in Ohio. No. Indiana. Ooh, Indianapolis, Indiana.
Okay.
So we're debating on doing Gen Con or Origins. Origins is in Ohio. It's a little more subdued. It's not everything, because they say that you need a week to walk around Gen Con, and it's only 4 days.
Wow.
So I'm thinking of going to Origins first, and then the year after that going to Gen Con and doing that whole experience. I'm not sure. We're going to kind of play it by ear, and I'm going to try and go anywhere we can.
Now, the last time you gave them a suggestion on kind of what your panel would be about, do you have to do that every time?
Every single time. And you have to provide a paragraph explanation that goes into the program.
Okay.
So they hand out the program at the beginning of the show of PAX. So as you're walking in, they hand you this booklet, and inside of it is our names, which was really surreal and weird. And then underneath it, you have to hit, there's like 5 topics you have to provide that you're going to hit during your hour. And then who all is involved in it. And they kind of take all of that into account, figure out that they're giving 4 3-day badges to you, you know, because we had 4 people going with us. And as long as all 4 of us were on stage and gave content or were used in some aspect They were fine with it, and they were really happy with our turnout and what we provided.
Did they actually give you direct feedback?
Not direct. We got it from the enforcers, which are the police of PAX. Yeah. Everybody hates them. Our enforcer for the panel was wonderful. She was she did a calming down exercise with Katie that was very strange, and then she was the one that told us that we had 186 people. We had another enforcer come up to us after the fact and say that he really liked it. He was standing in the back, didn't even notice him.
Ninja enforcers.
Yeah. And then PAX provided us with, they gave me like a really quick email saying, hey, we really appreciated it. The feedback has been pretty positive, so we'll probably have you back.
Yeah, that's good.
So yeah, it's neat. And we've already got an idea for next year. We're thinking of dividing the room into two or three and playing a game.
Okay.
So the people on the panel will be the main players of the game, but their choices will be influenced by the section of the room.
All right.
So that we're working with that idea. We're going to see if it actually can pan out or not.
Yeah.
Any plans of going to any of the other PAXes?
Yeah. If we can, we would like to go to PAX Prime. The one in Texas I heard is kind of sad.
Yeah, but that was the first year, and
right.
PAX East for the first year was kind of sad as well. So
Texas is sad in general.
I just don't want to go to Texas. That's my problem. Unless it's for Austin City Limits. No. What's the other one? Oh, shit. South by Southwest.
Okay.
Yeah. I would love to go to... I'm a huge music nerd. Like, it's really weird because a lot of people that don't know me brand me as a board game nerd or, like, just a nerd. And it's like, no, I'm a pop culture nerd. So movies, music, TV shows, like, everything. I'm a wealth of useless knowledge. and I just happen to focus all my energy on the board game side of it for what I present to the public.
Yeah, yeah.
So I don't make good life choices, basically, is what I'm saying.
Nice.
Worst life choice, go.
Getting married at 20.
Josh, do you have a worst life choice?
This podcast.
Oh, I hoped you would say getting married at 20.
No, Josh was in 20 when he got married.
I got married at 25.
Show off. no, I think that's probably my... Like, it was a knee-jerk reaction because she got pregnant and I got married.
So it was like a shotgun wedding.
It was very much a shotgun wedding. The events that occurred around that caused me to propose to her and then eventually get married, were very, very strange and messed up and therefore lead to me making the bad decision.
Yeah.
It's
always a chain reaction, I guess.
It was a poor life decision. I don't regret it. I learned a lot from it, and I have two kids that are awesome. So, yeah. But yeah, it's probably that's the worst decision I've made in my life.
I'm just trying to rack my brain for a worse decision.
Do you make decisions?
Not really.
Okay.
I just go every day. Actually, I wish I was more ignorant so that I could walk through the day and be like, oh, look at that butterfly.
I definitely wish that. But I've wished that more than one time. Like, I wish I could be completely oblivious to what people care. Like, just kind of do whatever.
Yeah, I mean, I was a hermit for a year. Still am a hermit. We're recording in my basement.
It's true.
I don't really leave my basement often.
I did the hermit thing for a little while. It was nice.
I guess everyone's done that.
It gets really lonely. I don't know if you've gotten to that point yet where you're just really bored and lonely.
I've run out of internet.
Right. That's when you hit the bottom of the internet, like you've scrolled through Tumblr and you're just like, ugh.
Actually, speaking of hermits, so many games, tabletop games, they allow one player mode. Have you ever done this?
Yes.
Is it actually fun?
How does that even work?
So depending on the game, it can be fun. Suburbia is a great example of it. So Suburbia is a game where you're building a town. Think the town of Agrestic from Weeds. And you're developing what kind of buildings go next to where and trying to make it as beautiful yet productive as you possibly can.
It's like SimCity?
Kind of, yeah. The one-player version of that is you are trying to create it within a certain amount of time with stuff getting randomly deleted from the game. So on your turn, certain stuff disappears at the end of it, and you won't have access to it for the rest of the game, and you're trying to see... Basically, you're trying to get a high score.
So it goes afterwards, you see how well you did.
Right, and that's how a lot of them go. Lord of the Rings, the LCG, is probably... trying to think if it's one of the only ones that you actually tell a story while you're doing it. Eldritch Horror you can play by yourself, and Arkham, and those are you just go up against the epic foe and see if you can win. But a lot of the more t- tile laying, building games, you're just trying to see how high of a score you can get in the time allotted.
Okay. I mean, me personally, I've been really getting into the games that create stories.
So Eldritch Horror as a solo game, you can do it one of two ways. One is you control one character and it's you against the world, or you can control two. So you take two characters' turns, and then the omen phase happens and all that stuff. So it's as if you're playing a two-player game, but by yourself.
Have you done it?
I haven't done that one, no. I've done Suburbia by myself. I've done Alhambra by myself, just because I absolutely love that game. I've played the Lord of the Rings LCG by myself, which is fun. The problem is, when you're playing by yourself, you have to be honest. And if the game wins, the game wins.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of, like... It's kind of like when you're playing solitaire and you're just like, I'm just going to pretend like this card was the one I flipped over.
Yeah, yeah.
Same idea. So it requires you to be a lot more honest with yourself and not cheat. But it can be fun. And some of them offer an experience that when you're done with it, you're like, okay, I didn't just waste 2 hours being a hermit and playing by myself.
Like, did you go into it when you were initially doing this? Did you go into it as... I'm going to try this because it might be fun, or I'm just bored.
I went into it to try it to see if it would be fun. I heard that Suburbia was really, really good as a solo game, and it was. It absolutely was. A lot of people say that when the game finishes, you're upset that it's over, and I love that feeling at the end of a game, video or analog.
Yeah.
When the game finishes and the credits are rolling and you're just like, oh. Five more minutes, like just one more hit, mom.
Yeah, yeah.
See, that's why you play an MMO, because they just never end.
I can't play an MMO. I don't have the patience.
I've been trying to get Josh to play WoW for years.
It's never going to happen.
I played WoW for 20 minutes.
See, that's more than Josh.
Yeah, I played WoW for 20 minutes, and then I deleted it from everything in my life and broke the disc and threw it away.
I did download it one time, and then I deleted it.
Oh, I bought it. Like, I bought one of the discs and everything, and I put it in. I loaded everything. I was like, this is going to be great. I started playing it, and I was like... I'm not doing it again. Like, the Star Wars one, the...
Galaxies or SWTOR?
SWTOR. After I, like, halfway through that, I was like, why have I wasted this much of my life doing this? Like, this is the most maniacally boring thing I've ever done.
Yeah. WoW gets pretty boring. After, because you just do the same thing week in, week out.
Right. Like, grinding my character and going on raids isn't a good time to me. It's not. I totally get it, too. There's a huge following to it, and there's a ton of people that do enjoy doing that. I like the social aspect of going on raids. I think that's beautiful. But for me, I would rather have friends over to the house and play a board game.
Yeah.
So, now, but I'm that way with all video games. Like, I don't want to single out WoW or Legends, LOL, League of Legends, or any of those players. Like, you guys, you are what makes the gaming community what it is, and that's not... a negative thing. It's absolutely a positive. You have brought a social aspect to video gaming that hasn't been there for a very long time, since I'd say the N64, early PlayStation 2 era.
Yeah.
Where a lot of people can get together and play a game and not call each other a bunch of names. It happens still, but you are trying. You're doing your best. So I don't want that to seem like I'm bashing all of you. It's not my particular cup of tea.
Yeah. Yeah, everyone has their niche that they just fit into better.
Did that just blow your mind that I was actually trying not to be offensive?
We would just edit you out anyway.
Okay. Edit that whole thing out where I apologize to both of those communities.
All it's just going to go back to is everything sucks.
Yeah, just WoW sucks. You guys all suck.
Then just we...
just isolate that and loop it.
Like, we edit you into the video. You're just knocking the mic over and kicking a table and walking out.
Are you just
I can just do that.
No, you can just set my WoW Collector's Editions on fire if you want.
No, see, I respect that. I think that's a beautiful thing. Although it does lead to you being a hermit and living down here forever. So, but no, I think like your devotion to the game is beautiful.
It's not.
I wish I could be devoted to something it's like dark. That ever in my life, because I'm not.
Well, I guess that's the thing, because even in tabletop games, there definitely are games that people devote their life to, like Magic, Dungeons & Dragons.
Magic, D&D, Warhammer, or any of the painted miniatures.
Yeah, it's a big one.
I mean, honestly, you can devote your life to Settlers of Catan if you want. There's seven or eight expansions. Carcassonne, the one where you're laying tiles and building a city, and there's roads and shit. That has 28 expansions. So you can absolutely devote your life to a game. We played Twilight Imperium on the show for our 100th episode, or our 99, our first episode of season two. It's all drifting together now. So the first episode of season two is a 12-hour epic of us playing a game called Twilight Imperium, which is basically Star Wars, the board game. Like, if you took all six Star Wars movies and put it into a board game, that's what this game is. Each race can build a Death Star. There's political war. There's actual war. There's people that just want to build up and they can get points that way. Like, it is Star Wars, the board game, and it's beautiful.
Now, you personally like that style of game? Like, the big sprawling, like, this game might take a week to play?
I don't mind it. Not at all. It's not necessarily my go-to, because I do like the ADD aspect of playing a 45-minute game, playing another 45-minute game.
Just keep moving.
Yeah. But every so often, like, we will get together and play Eldritch and or Arkham, and yeah. I really do enjoy those. It's a nice afternoon, and Twilight Imperium kind of falls into that realm of being a very epic game that you devote a day to, and when it's over, you are very happy that you had the experience, and you'll see everybody in 6 months.
Is that the longest game you've ever played?
Hands down, the longest game we've ever played.
And you did that in one shot, right?
We did it, yeah. So we learned it and played it in one night. We were set to have 12 hours, no problem. Everybody was supposed to arrive at noon, and some people arrived at 2. Everybody was there by 3. We started playing the game at 5, and then at 9 we went for dinner, and we finished around 2 or 3 a.m. So it was a very, very long game.
So you recorded a podcast or video?
Both.
Are both released?
No. They will both... So the audio will go up in towards the end of May. It's the start of season 2. That is episode 101. And then the video, I'm still editing because it was massive.
I can't even imagine. What was the file size for that?
Well, the one was on the Polaroid Cube. That was 8 gig. And the other one was on a digital camera that I have, and that came up to about 12 or 13 gig.
So that's kind of... Are you still editing?
I'm still in the process of editing it, yeah. Because I'm trying to cut out the boring parts and show the board movement and make it interesting and try to keep it under an hour. Because I don't think anybody wants to watch...
So you're going to edit, whatever, 11 or 12 hours down to an hour?
Yes.
Ooh, that's rough. Okay,
good luck.
Yeah, it's right now, it's the way that it's getting set up is it's being told in 5-minute clips that kind of show a major event happening and then move on to the next major event.
Okay.
Because that's kind of how the game plays out. There's a couple of turns of nothing, 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 major event, nothing, nothing, major event.
So I imagine, plus I imagine because it was everyone's first time, there was probably like a lot of, I don't know what to do.
The whole game. So that's the other weird part about the video. I don't know for sure that I'm going to release it. I've developed a ton of anxiety over the last few years because of random shit that's happened in my life. And so I get this weird tick where my neck kind of goes out and I kind of do that a lot. By the end of that game, I couldn't talk normally without my neck doing that.
Like, so, you were just so annoyed of waiting for everyone?
No, answering the same question over and over and over
again.
Oh,
okay.
Yeah, so the way that I started editing it was I went to the very end to get the resolution of everything and make sure that that was what I wanted and see how long that took. And then that would decide how long the rest of the video was going to be. And the whole time you see me just sitting there, like just tweaking out because my anxiety and my stress was so through the roof.
Yeah. Maybe that's one of those things you're just better off re-recording with a handful of people that know what to do.
We were talking about, so we want to do Twilight Imperium as the first episode of every season. So after 100 episodes, we play Twilight Imperium again.
It's interesting to see how you guys evolve with it.
Right, and we can add expansions. There's 2 expansions for it that make it even bigger and badder. Bigger and badder and longer and stuff. And so we kind of want to see where we can go with that. So we might just bag it, and then I will release the video of our second playthrough as our first.
Okay.
See how that goes. Or just being the first video of us playing it.
Yeah.
Because at least 4 of the people at the table will know how to play it.
Hopefully.
Hopefully.
Yeah. Or just release the whole thing.
I was debating that, like, just so you can watch the decimation of my character over...
just your mental breakdown.
Seriously, over 12 hours, you can see me. I start out just fine. I'm happy. I'm good. And within the first hour, I start clicking. And then by the end, it's a nonstop. So if you just fast forward through it, you see me just fall apart as a human.
See, I can handle... Like, I played Eldritch a bunch of times, and that can be 6 hours or so. I can handle that, but, man, 11, 12 hours, that's a long time to sit there.
We honestly didn't notice that it was taking... I didn't notice that it was taking that long to play it. The game itself takes about 8 to 9 hours if everybody knows how to play it.
Okay.
So, you know when we play those six-hour games of Eldritch, and we end it, and we go, that was awesome.
Yeah.
Like, there's never a point when it's 6 hours long. We're actually surprised to see that it took six hours. That's kind of how this game goes.
So the game's balanced enough where it's like you're at the edge of your seat, kind of?
There's enough momentum. You are genuinely terrified of what everybody else is going to do their turn.
So you're everyone's against each other?
More or less, yes. You can develop alliances across the table. There's a very cool mechanic for that. So it's better to get into an alliance with people, but there's some people that they just don't want to bother and don't care, and they're just going to come around and kill everybody.
Okay, so it's pretty much like those shady backdoor Monopoly deals, but it's part of the game.
Don't bring up shady backdoor Monopoly deals.
And so many. That's why Monopoly is the darkest game you can play.
That's why Monopoly's banned.
Yep.
You know, Monopoly is a perfect game.
Have you guys ever played Monopoly on the show?
No, but that was one of the things in our panel that we did talk about, that Monopoly is not a bad game if you actually play it right. No money ever goes on free parking, and if you go bankrupt, you're bankrupt. When somebody can't buy a property, you auction it off. Like, the rules are the rules because it'll make the game fun.
Yeah, it doesn't stretch it out forever.
The game should take about 45 minutes to an hour to play.
Wow, really? I've definitely never done that. I'm usually 3-4 hours.
I played a 25-minute game of it at Cloud City against a guy who was ranked as a world champion of it. And
they have rankings for Monopoly?
They have rankings for everything. Have you been on the internet?
Not that part.
I thought you'd been to all of the internet.
Yeah. You obviously haven't reached the rock bottom of your hermitdom. There's world championships for Settlers of Catan and like all these weird games that you wouldn't expect there to be a world championship of, because the game itself doesn't really lend itself to being super strategic.
Yeah, like stat-based type.
Yeah, but, right. But you can't be the world champion out of two people.
Right. It's true.
But so how bad did you do against this guy?
I didn't do that bad. I knew going into it what I was up against. Like, I know aggressive play in Monopoly, which sounds really weird to say out loud, but there is absolutely aggressive play in Monopoly. The guy, there was four people at the table. Two of them had no clue. They didn't even know who this guy was.
Excuse me.
Bless you. They had no clue who the guy was, and the two of us wound up steamrolling the other two. They went bankrupt within 10 minutes. And then he and I were duking it out at the end, and it was really, really fun.
Wait, so you actually played this with like four people and only went 25 minutes?
25 minutes.
Wow. I was impressed because I thought it was one versus one and it went 25 minutes.
No, four people, 25 minutes.
Wow.
And it was super aggressive. It was awesome. And if you start to role play your character of the as like you're a billionaire buying this property, it becomes really funny.
Would you say is that the number one game that's played wrong?
Absolutely, of any game, video or analog, that is the number one game that is played wrong, and it's because we've come from a generation of pussification, where a lot of people house rule the game so that way it's easier absolutely. To play. And what they consider to be more fun, but the game is meant to be a cutthroat real estate game. Like, it's Donald Trump, the board game, without funky hair and you're fired. Like, you are supposed to try and make the other people go bankrupt. You want to ruin their lives. You want to ruin them.
I went to school with the granddaughter of the guy that invented Monopoly.
Monopoly was invented by a girl. It was stolen by that guy.
Really?
Yeah. It's a huge thing, too. A lot of people will say, like, that guy's relatively famous, you know.
Yeah,
like,
absolutely.
And a lot of people have known him or seen him or gone to speeches from him, and it came out, I mean, it's always been known that a female, I forget her name, but a woman developed the game, and it was the IP was stolen by him and produced. Milton Bradley was notorious for that. Milton Bradley and Parker Brothers would find IP. So if you and I created a game that would be a great family game, we would pitch it to them, and they would go, we're not that interested. And then 2 years later, you see a game that looks exactly like ours, just slightly changed so they don't get sued.
Yeah. So even what you're saying is even at the business level, no one plays Monopoly right.
Even at the business... Well, no. At the business level, they play it exactly right. They were playing it perfectly. So unforgiving, unruly. Like, Dane Cook's joke, and I hate to bring up Dane Cook, but
Dane Cook in his heyday was fantastic.
He was amazing. Well, we were also all teenagers, and like that was, we thought somebody jumping around stage was comedy.
That's true. I saw him at his peak.
and then we discovered Louis C.K.
But Dane Cook at his peak, when everyone knew all his jokes, they would yell out the punchline, and he would like belligerently yell at the crowd to shut up.
Nice. So his joke of fuck this grandma, you know,
yeah, yep,
flipping the table with Monopoly, that is such a perfect description of what playing Monopoly nowadays is. You should have that same reaction if you're playing it right, but not because it's taken 3 hours.
It's just that it's so intense.
You are so angry at the person that just ruined you. Like, that reaction is pure for both ways of playing it. It's just the difference is the time frame that it takes to get there.
I really want to see you guys do a straight video feed of your crew playing Monopoly, because you have some very specific angry characters.
I've brought it up numerous times about playing Monopoly, and nobody is interested in it.
But I want to. You have the perfect crew to do it.
We really do. We played a game called Cube Quest, which is you have two rubber mats facing each other and these little dice, and you flick them at each other. And whatever falls off the board is considered killed.
Okay.
So really dumb, simple game, meant for kids, but there's enough strategy in it because you can change out what characters do what for adults and stuff. And we played it with Luigi and Matt, and there was a point where they kept putting their arms up against the back of the mat so it would bounce off and land back on the mat. And we called one out for Luigi, and then Matt did the exact same thing and said it was in, and we were like, no, that was clearly out. And that's where the thing in our opening theme song of You're Not Taking This Away From Me.
Okay, I always wondered where that came from.
That's where that came from. It's in the episode. And that was the nearest table flip moment we've had. I've had Matt get salty. I've gotten salty at a game. But that was the most pure, like, he is going to break the table any second.
So moment. No one's ever legit rage quit out of a game?
You can argue that I did, but the game was already over. Somebody had made me skip my turn, and I realized somebody else was going to win that round. So I just got up, walked away, said, fuck it, you win, go ahead, and grabbed a soda from the fridge and came back and sat down.
So that was the only rage, semi-rage quit?
You
knew there was no way out at that point.
There was another game, the first time that we did a live event where we were playing at the Portal, we all unanimously agreed that the game was awful. I was the one that started the rage quit, and it takes so much for me to get angry at anything. And this game was just so bad. It's called Tentacle Bento. I have no problem saying that. It's by Soda Pop Miniatures. It is a rummy clone that has special rules in it that fuck with everybody. And it's just really bad. It is an unplayable game. There was a point where all I could do was take the top card off of the deck, set it down in front of me, and go ahead. And there was a point where we were really, really close to winning. Somebody at the table was going to win. And it wasn't me. I was so far removed from the game. And I drew a card that made everything reset.
Oh, fantastic.
So, yeah. So it's as if we're starting the game over again. And I just said, fuck this. And I pushed everything into the center of the table. And everybody said, thank God. Because my number one rule for the show is we play any game that gets dropped on the table and we play it till it's done.
Yeah.
So everybody was playing because of my rule.
Okay.
So the fact that I was the one that was like, fuck this, we're done. They were like, yes. Like, they were so happy that we decided to stop that.
Yeah. Do you, if you had to suggest any game for the average person to play that they probably never heard of, what would it be?
If you want a card-based game, Star Realms, it's a deck builder. So you both start off with the same deck and you use cards as currency to buy other cards in the game. You're trying to punch each other until one of you dies. Really easy to learn. Really, really fun to play.
Didn't you do this on a video?
We've done Star Realms on video. We've done an episode for the show with our full review. It is Katie's favorite game, and she hates the genre of deck building, and she hates games. And it's her favorite game.
Yeah.
So there's
how much is that about?
It's $15 for the full game, and there's a free app where you can play it against the computer, and then I think it's like $3 or $4 to unlock it for online play against anybody. Really, really, really fun game.
Yeah, that's cool.
If you don't want a card-based game, probably... it's kind of a card-based game, but Machi Koro. We played that on the YouTube channel with my daughter Grace. You are building a city, and you buy cards... You buy buildings to represent what your city is. You're trying to be the best mayor. And there's player interaction, but for the most part, it can just be a fun game. And it's, again, super easy to learn. And everybody at the table can have fun.
Okay. Last question I pretty much have for you. Do you guys, Do you have a rule? Do you always play the games by the set rules? Or do you ever add house rules to your games for podcast-wise?
So for the podcast, we generally try to follow the rules as close as we can. A lot of times we're learning it as we're playing it on the show because the whole idea is it's that first playthrough.
Yep.
So how easy was it to learn? How easy was it to play? And was it fun? Every so often we will house rule something just because it's easier to do for the audio of the podcast and it makes it more fun. The most notable one of that is the Once Upon a Time story time episodes. We're playing a storytelling game where one of the rules is if somebody says something that is so bizarre and weird, you can say no, silly, and it stops the game. They lose their turn, moves to the next player. We immediately removed that rule because we found it to be really dumb. We want the story to go as off the rails as it possibly can and be the most bizarre thing you've ever heard. So, but for the most part, yeah, we try not to house rule anything because house rules tend to ruin a game. It's understandable when you're playing with kids or new players that you would house rule something just so that way an event can't occur where they would not like the game.
Yeah.
But as a general practice, when you're playing the game, like when we played Machi Koro with my daughter, there are cards in there that are red cards where if you were to roll a number on the die, I would get to take a certain number of coins from you. And it was brought up that we should probably remove those for Grace's first play. And I go, no, absolutely keep those in because then she'll learn. You know, it's a learning part.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, like the world isn't fair and you're going to lose all of your money. And she wound up buying the most of the red cards. Like she bought as many of them as she possibly could. She was rolling mean mode.
So would you say that's your main, if you had to tell somebody that's trying to get into it just for a start, always play by the rules?
I mean, that's life in general. You can bend the rules, and there's bending the rules and breaking the rules. And if you bend the rules, you can have a really good time. But if you break them, you're going to ruin it for everybody.
And I guess it does make sense because these games have been play tested for endless hours before they release them.
Yeah, there's a reason that the rules are included in the box, and it's not to fill out the rest of the space in the box so the lid closes right. It's because that is how you play the game, and that is what the designer was going for.
Yeah.
So if you throw those out at the beginning, then you are losing 90% of what the game is.
Yeah.
So, although there is, I forget if it's a podcast or a video, where they open the box, they remove the rules, and they try to figure out how to play the game just based off of the components. And it's really entertaining.
Yeah, it's actually kind of funny.
So, yeah, if I think of it, I'll message you guys with it, and you can link it to this or whatever.
Yeah.
All right, so Tim, we have a couple questions we'd like to ask you.
Oh, boy.
Now, these are all yes or no questions.
All right, I'm going to take a sip of my soda first.
And we will score you at the end of this.
What page are you on so I'm not on the same page?
I have different questions.
Ah, okay, that makes this easy.
It's like you thought this one out.
All right, Tim, yes or no questions.
Mm-hmm.
If it's tourist season, why can't we shoot them?
Yes.
Why is a boxing ring square?
No.
If work is so terrific, how come you get paid for it?
No.
Why is clear considered a color?
Yes.
If Jimmy cracks corn and no one cares, why is there a song about him?
Yes.
Why do we scrub down and wash up?
No.
Why do kamikaze pilots wear helmets?
Yes.
That's my favorite question, by the way.
That's a good one.
Let's see here.
If space is a vacuum, who changes the bags?
No.
What color would a Smurf be if he choked?
Yes.
That's completely wrong. That's all right. I got.
All right, let's see if I can find one more good one, and then we'll give you a score here. Why don't you ever see ads for advertising companies?
Yes.
All right. I don't know, Josh. What do you think?
It was a mediocre.
Yellow belt?
About.
All right, so you earned the Six Sigma yellow belt.
Fair enough. I have no clue what that means. I want to know how you guys are figuring out these victory points. Where's your rule set?
It's a secret formula that we know.
Yeah, we're not allowed to release that. We've play tested that for hours, and that's why the game came out so perfect.
Only for hours?
Like maybe 20 minutes, if you want to get specific about it.
That sounds about right.
That's kind of a stretch as well.
That's kind of how long our concept took to create this.
Yeah, as a whole. Like even the website.
Yeah, no, I totally get it. Ours was about the same. It was, we recorded episode zero, and then I sent a message to a friend saying, hey, I want to start a website. So we were already producing content, and then I was like,
I guess I should have somewhere to put it.
I need somewhere to store this shit.
So, Tim, why don't you tell everyone how they can find you and your content?
www.sorryfarted.com is the best way to find us. The only other place that doesn't use Sorry Farted as its acronym, so Facebook, Twitter, that's all Sorry Farted, is YouTube. We are Smith TV, SMIF TV.
Okay, fantastic. And Josh, why don't you tell how people to find our content?
SuperNerdFactory.com.
So that'll do it for this week's, whatever we're calling this show.
The Unnamed Show.
The Unnamed Show. All right, everyone.
You got to come back again sometime.
Oh, I'll come back anytime you guys want.
Oh, we got stories about Tim.
Oh, yes. Oh, yeah, you guys didn't even scratch the surface.
Yeah, but there's some dark places where we're going to go in future episodes.
I've seen some shit.
All right. Literally. With that, have a good week.